Thank you.
Yesterday's heroes, R.G. Reid, 1142245008. Producer Cal, VTR October 482, playback TV, and hold the tape, please.
It was a cold winter's night, not a star was in sight, as we rolled down the hill to randomness, on a CNR bus that had caused quite a fuss by replacing our Newfoundland Express.
The Newfoundland Express, its demise at the hands of the heartless bureaucrats of the CNR, immortalized by folk singer Joan Morrissey in one of her most popular songs. Hello, I'm Harry Brown. For me and for many today, I'm sure, the old passenger train that we remember so well was a potent symbol of our century-long struggle for independence as the gloriously free Dominion of Newfoundland. Welcome this week to the story of that struggle and of the man who built our railway, Sir Robert Gillespie Reid, one of the most abused and adventurous of yesterday's heroes.
Kidneys will never stand the
strain. Maggie Hawkins, the heroine of our song, missed the commodious washrooms on the old train after imbibing some local beer on the hated bus, and the result was explosive.
Now with a final lash, Maggie sucked in her cheeks and a great burst of fire and of steam. And a thunderous roar that shook the valley and the shore, and the bus blew apart beside a stream.
To appreciate how much other Newfoundlanders miss seeing the much maligned bullet rattle its way across our rugged island, one must first understand the incredible political, financial, and physical struggle it took to put it there in the first place.
Newfoundland is the only colony of any importance under the crown without a railroad. And the advances...
Develop mineral and agricultural resources, increase revenue and immigration, trade, import and export, produce employment and be the most...
Speeches in the House of Assembly in 1881. In the midst of a frenzy of railway building in North America, Newfoundland was not to be denied its entry to the modern world. Railway boosters even suggested that the ship journey from Europe could be shortened by 4 days with a rail line across the island and a ferry connection to North Sydney. Despite some opposition from fearful merchants, Sir William Whiteway proposed in the legislature in 1880 the colony build a narrow gauge railway from St. John's to Halls Bay, the site of promising copper and zinc mines, at a cost of $4 million. Dr. James Hiller of Memorial University is the author of a history of the Newfoundland Railway.
Okay. Tenders were called at that point, and in the end the successful bidder was a syndicate called the Newfoundland Railway Company, which was a New York-based group represented here by one Blackman, Albert Blackman. They began work in 1881. And they built as far as Whitburn and then a branch line along the north shore of Conception Bay as far as Harbour Grace. That was completed by about 1884. And of course, well before that time, the excursion trains and the irregular trains around the bay were in fact starting to run.
Not everyone was pleased with the leap toward progress. Both the Anglican and Methodist churches protested the popular Sunday excursions to the resort village of Topsail.
That whereas we have the solemn command in God's word to remember the Sabbath day, therefore be it resolved that this conference hereby enter its solemn protest against the violation of the divine law.
The churchmen didn't have long to wait for their revenge. It wasn't the hand of God that intervened, however, but earthly creditors. And within 3 years, the Newfoundland Railway Company was bankrupt, having completed barely 90 miles to Harbour Grace.
The legislature then decided the most efficient way to build a rail line was to find a contractor who would do the work for a fixed price. Tenders were published, and the lowest bid proposed by Robert Gillespie Reid, the most renowned railroad builder of the day. R.G. Reid was born in the village of Cooper Angus, Perthshire, on the coast of Scotland, where his father owned a small linen mill. At 17, he was apprenticed to a local builder who operated a stone quarry and learned the trade of stonemason. In 1865, at the age of 23, he did what most adventurous young men of that era wanted to do, set out for the gold fields of faraway Australia to seek his fortune. Although he had little success in finding gold, Reid supported himself by building stone bread ovens for the crowded camps and graduated to building stone viaducts and bridges in the Australian railroad building frenzy that preceded ours. By 1890, he had immigrated to Canada through the United States and was settled in Montreal with a wife and three sons as a millionaire member of that city's business elite, with 20 years of successful rail and bridge contracting behind him. R.G. Reid tendered to complete the line to Halls Bay for $15,000 a mile and to accept payment in local government debentures. The eminent engineer's fixed price and his obvious faith in the financial stability of the Dominion delighted the legislature and gave no hint that Reid was to be the first in a long line of foreign entrepreneurs to meet disaster at the hands of local politicians.
And so he started work soon after the contract was assigned, and he worked really quite fast. Now, when the line got to the exploits, and it was decided at that point to turn the line to the west and then south down to Port of Basque. So two new contracts were signed. The first was that he would complete the line to the west, and that he would run the trains on the line, manage the operation of the line for 10 years. And for this he would be paid in land. And this is the start of the great land holdings that the Reeds acquired.
The railway was built by hand. It must have been quite a sight to see the cooking fires of 1,000 men spread along 5 to 10 miles of grade. They lived in tents and tar paper shacks, and they cooked their damper dogs over fires on the railway shovels. They earned $1 a day for 10 hours. It was rugged and it was primitive, but it was a great adventure, and nobody complained. The first train across Newfoundland ran on June the 29th, 1898, and it took 28 hours to make the trip. But there was little cause for celebration. Reid had operated through some of the most perilous times the colony had ever faced. There was a bank crash, which threatened its payment and colonial debentures, and a disastrous fishery. And the railway started to lose money, and it failed to generate the development and create the prosperity which its backers had hoped for. A barely solvent government was faced with taking over this looming disaster as Reid's 10-year operating contract reached expiry. What was to happen? What could anyone do? The answer was found in the notorious contract of 1898, which threatened political chaos and headed the Reid Empire into financial disaster.
Well, at this stage, Reid came forward with a proposal, which in essence said that he was prepared to take the line off the sort of hands of the government in perpetuity. They proposed essentially that they would maintain the operation of the line for a further 50 years, and in return for that, they wanted more land. At the end of those 50 years, they proposed that the line should become the property of the Reid family. And in return for that right, they were prepared to pay the government of the day $1 million straight off the top. Now beyond that, and this is the second part of the deal, they proposed that they would have a near monopoly of the steamship service on the coast, the telegraph system of the ferry to Port of Basque, that they would also purchase the dry dock in St. John's, and of course this was to be part of their whole transportation system.
The political leaders were delighted with the Reid offer. First of all, they'd receive $1 million in cash immediately to pay off some outstanding bills, they'd ensure development under an economic dictatorship, and they'd be rid of the pestiferous railway for the rest of their natural lives. But the British government was horrified, and a rising young politician named Robert Bond decided to use opposition to the deal as a stepping stone to the Prime Minister's office in St. John's.
The government system of railways has cost this country $12 million. And this we are now asked to barter away for less than 1/12 of that amount. I say no to Mr. Reid. Only 3 years ago, we affirmed that these assets, the railway, the dry dock, and the telegraph lines were worth over $12 million. And today, we solemnly declare, through the voice of our Parliament, that we will give them away for 1/12 that sum. Let this proposal receive the sanction of this legislature, and we will become a byword for stupidity and a disgrace throughout the civilized world.
We hold this country in trust for those who come after us and for our children.
The legislature did approve the contract. But Bond's opposition stirred up such a clamor among the public that an election was fought on the issue, and he was returned as Prime Minister with the largest majority attained up to that time in the Newfoundland House of Assembly. Within a year, he forced the Reids at least to modify the hated contract.
What Bond insisted upon was that if the Reids were to be allowed to incorporate as the Reid Newfoundland Company, then they would have to agree to give up their right to the reversion of the a railway after 50 years to the Reid family. That the Reeds agreed to do. Well, if everything had gone through, if there had been no renegotiation of the deal in 1901, then the total land holding would have been in the region of 6 million acres. The Reeds, of course, agreed to give up the additional land grants to which they had been entitled under the 1898 deal. So those were the two basic things. They also agreed to a modification of the deal on the telegraphs so that they remained with the Newfoundland government and not with a private company.
As members of the wealthiest families and the ruling elite of Newfoundland, the Bonds and the Reeds had once been friends, but now they became the deadliest of enemies. Understandably, R.G. Reid and his sons concluded that the only way that they could continue the successful development of the considerable resources they still held in Newfoundland was to get rid of this fanatical patriot and replace him with a more pliable representative. And this they set out to do with vigor, determination, and a great deal of money.
Since the start of the Bond administration, the Reeds had had a champion within the administration in the person of Sir Edward Morris. Now, when the Reeds decided that a Bond would have to be replaced, then they naturally turned to Sir Edward Morris. And Morris resigned from the administration on a transparent pretext, founded his own People's Party, funded by the Reeds, and very much running in the sort of interests of the Reed Newfoundland Company. It was a tie election, which was, of course, quite unheard of. There were no precedents to sort of guide anybody on this. And it's a very famous incident in Newfoundland history.
The tie election produced a constitutional crisis, and it was left to the governor of the day to decide who the prime minister would be. For Bond, surrounded by enemies, it was a dangerous hour, and his negotiations with Governor Sir William MacGregor, who was a great friend of the Reeds, were disastrous.
Edward Morris writes me, Mr. Balmer, that from the granting of responsible government in Newfoundland, the invariable practice has been for the leader of a government, having failed to secure a majority, to tender his resignation.
Perhaps he should also have written, Your Honour, that the governor accepts his advice from the Prime Minister alone, and not from the leader of the opposition, or from the Reid family.
My decisions, sir, are based solely upon interpretation of constitutional law and guidance from the Colonial Office.
Then both sources should tell you, sir, that I am Prime Minister of this country, and I demand a dissolution and a new election so that I can solve the crisis.
After you meet the Assembly and elect a Speaker.
I do not have to meet with the House of Assembly.
I would be derelict in my duty to the people.
Your duty, sir, is to listen to your First Minister, the duly elected representative of the people. If you refuse to do so, then you leave me no alternative but to offer my resignation and to say that this country has returned to a dictatorship. You shall have my resignation in the morning.
Bond resigned, and it was Morris who met the House in the spring of 1909, where he was defeated in his turn, but he got the dissolution. And so it was Morris, who was Premier, went to the country in the spring of 1909, and he won a quite decent majority after a very bitter election indeed.
With the defeat of his political nemesis, Robert Bond, came the death in 1908 of Sir Robert Gillespie Reid, knighted the previous year for outstanding service to the Empire, his estate valued at $10 million.
The Reed sons went ahead with grandiose plans for development and were instrumental in having two great pulp and paper mills established at Grand Falls and Corner Brook. Ironically, the attempt by Edward Morris to repay his political debts by giving them contracts to build unprofitable branch lines only led to continuing financial crisis, for they had built a railway to nowhere. By 1923, the deficit was a staggering $6 million, and the government faced stark alternatives: bail the company out, take over the operation, or close it down. The decision was to pay the Reeds $2 million for their track and stock and take over. The line continued to lose money until World War II, when providing yeoman service, it finally turned a modest profit.
But bad times soon returned for the Bullet. After Confederation in 1949, Canadian National took charge. They ended passenger service and recommended abandonment of the line altogether in favor of highway and marine transport. The present administration has rejected this proposal. Other Newfoundlanders who rejected are those who recall fondly the rowdy, boisterous hospitality of the Trans Island Run, and who regard the railway still as a symbol of one great attempt by a tiny country and an adventurous Scot to establish a prosperous patch of empire in the oldest colony.
On a bend on a hill, just outside Clarenville, her tombstone says she never died in vain. And long may she fly to that great bathroom in the sky, for someday they'll give us back our train.
If Maggie's dream never comes true, perhaps it will stand as a tribute to R.G. Reed's, whose steadfast devotion to his own marks him as one of the most daring, adventurous, and frustrated of yesterday's heroes. I'm Harry Brown, and I'll see you next week.
The CBC gratefully acknowledges the cooperation of the Newfoundland Transport History Society in the preparation of this program.